Hello, and welcome to Classical Pairings, a podcast exploring interactions between music and all things food and drink. I'm your host, Nick Johnson.
I want to hear your grouper.
Actually, most of it's a little bit of grouper, a little bit fishy.
In each episode, we pair a leader in music with a leader in the food and drink industry, and we talk connections, similarities, and differences. What drives a person to become a musician, or open a brewery, or start a restaurant? Are they passionate, dreamers, or just crazy? I'm a musicology professor, but I like to think of myself as a connoisseur of cocktails and beer, so I'm always excited to talk with people that share my combined passions. And, as our name suggests, we'll spend some time eating and drinking samples selected just for us. And I'll try to pick classical music I think pairs well with whatever we're sampling. You can tell me what you think of my choices by following me on Twitter at MusicologyNick. My guests for this episode included Neal Brown, owner of Neal Brown Hospitality and several restaurants and bars around Indianapolis, and Michael Schelle, a professor of composition at Butler University. We recorded this episode at the Libertine Bar on Mass Ave, and we'll jump in with our guests introducing themselves. Later in this episode, we'll pick music to pair with two extremely unique cocktails that are staples on Libertine's menu. Welcome to another episode of Classical Pairings. We are here at the Libertine, a delicious cocktail bar on Mass Ave. I'm sitting here with Neal Brown from the Libertine and Mike Schelle, a composer. So I'm going to go ahead and just have them introduce themselves a little bit, and then we'll get started. Mike, you want to go first?
Hi, it's great to be here. I'm Mike Schelle. I teach in the composition department at Butler University. All the new Stravinsky and Charles Ives wannabes, which is really challenging in the 21st century, yeah. Because these kids were all born after all my heroes were already dead. So it's a challenge, but it keeps me young too, okay. To work with 18-year-old composers and 20-year-old composers. So
how long have you been composing?
I personally have been writing for, I'm in my 60s, let's put it that way.
Okay.
I started a little bit late. I was in pre-med, then I went into theater. I was a theater major and studied poetry and philosophy. And when I was a senior in college in Philadelphia, I heard a piece called The Rite of Spring. Never heard of it before, never heard of Stravinsky. Yeah. What I knew of classical music was Beethoven and Chopin, and it didn't speak to me. But I heard this piece, and I thought, oh, my God, this is you can do this? And almost overnight, I quit my rock and roll band and pursued that, and I was 20. So,
wow, and now you're sitting here in this moment.
And now I'm sitting here at the apex of my career. This is great.
That's great. All right, Neal, would you introduce yourself?
Also at the apex of my career. My name is Neal Brown. I'm a chef, restaurateur here in Indianapolis. I've been cooking in Indianapolis, believe it or not, for about 20 years now. I own several restaurants, Libertine, of course, Yukio. Daredevil Hall is our newest restaurant on 82nd Street. And I'm opening a restaurant in Butler University, believe it or not, at Resco Hall.
Oh, you are?
I am, wow. Yep. Called Midtown Provisions.
Great.
Which is, we'll be opening, fingers crossed, I can't believe I'm getting ready to say this, January.
Wow.
Okay. I can't wait.
Contingency plan is spring.
Okay.
So I've been cooking here in the city for quite some time. I'm very passionate about spirits and cocktails. Mm-hmm. So this should be a very fun conversation. And music. I'm very passionate about music.
Yeah, what kind of music?
I listen to everything. I'm not one of the guys that say I like everything but country or I like everything but rap because yeah. I like country. I like rap.
Mm-hmm.
I literally listen to everything. I have season tickets to the symphony.
Right.
I love jazz. So there's nothing that I don't love. Nothing I don't touch. Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's fantastic.
Depending on the mood.
Okay, yeah. So the reason... Some of these episodes we have kind of a theme, and we for this one, I'm sort of calling it the avant-garde, which may be a little tongue-in-cheek. But anyway, thinking about sort of people looking forward in music and in cocktails and in food, I think certainly when I was trying to think of a bar in town that sort of struck me as a place having really innovative, creative cocktails, Libertine actually came to mind. I'm really glad we were able to set this up. And Mike, I know you've written music that's very sort of progressive and cutting-edge and we'll talk about some of that later. By the way, there'll be links to all these projects online that people can see. So anyway, I want us to sort of be thinking about, as we're talking about this, sort of what drives you to innovate, how do you respond to what's been happening in the past, those sorts of things. So why don't we just start with a more general question. What
or how do you maintain, both of you, whoever wants to go first, kind of a spirit of innovation in the things you're doing? You've got so many restaurants you're talking about, you're continuing opening, you continue to write music that's being performed all over the world. But you've both been doing this for quite some time. So what pushes you to keep innovating?
Mike, go ahead. I'm going to think.
One of my teachers, I don't want to name drop, one of the engineers here said he loves to name drop. I do too. One of my teachers was Aaron Copland, and when I studied with him, he had already quit composing, and he was in his mid-60s when he quit. I'm a little bit beyond that right now. Every piece I do, it just becomes my favorite piece, and I want to see, like, what can I pull off here? What can I do here? And who might be interested? And if they're not interested, that's okay. And I still have that kind of idealistic approach. I'm not trying to please people or fill a need. I'm trying to create a need, actually. I think like you do with your experiments.
Yeah.
Nobody needed the Rite of Spring until it was written. Now everybody needs it. And I'm not actually putting myself in that category, but... I just still enjoy doing it. I did three big pieces this summer, and I loved every minute. We have to go back to teaching.
Yeah.
But that's okay. That's okay. I love that, too. Yeah. You can be creative in teaching.
Yeah,
My slightly older brother is a surgeon. He's retired. And we had a discussion years ago. He has a lot of money. But he said, I'm so jealous of you because you can do whatever you want. I can't. If somebody has a heart attack, I can't say, let's try going through the back and see what happens, whereas I can with my music. So it's really nice.
You did three pieces this summer.
Three pieces this summer. Yeah.
Does volume of work affect creativity for you?
It can. These are all shorter pieces, all under 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. So that's a great question. If I'm doing a larger piece, like I did an opera a couple of years ago, that'll just consume me for the year. These are all shorter projects.
Because three pieces to me in a summer sounds like a monumental task, but probably to you it's not, right?
Yeah.
It's still a big deal.
Well, it begs the question, does it become routine? And I have to be really careful each time that it doesn't become routine, that it's still fresh. And you borrow on certain stylistic things that you know you're comfortable with and you know you enjoy. But it's like, well, let's try this. I haven't tried that before. Yeah. You might fail, you might succeed, but yeah.
So, you know, the same thing that inspires me is also the same thing that frustrates me in this industry. You will be able to relate to this, Mike. The restaurant industry is a young industry. We have young people. We have an influx of young people at all times coming into our restaurants. That can be very, very challenging, very frustrating, because you're teaching the same techniques. You're teaching the same things over and over and over and over again, right? Because you're just teaching a new wave of people. That being said, those young people tend to also be the things that inspire my cooking these days the most. Their ideas... things that we can sort of take away from and frankly watch them develop and then I can help them refine. My job these days is more as a distiller, frankly, of these ideas. I say no a lot more than I say yes, and just helping people distill their ideas. You know, I'm not an active chef in these restaurants as much as I used to be, so my innovation comes from a little bit remotely. So it's someone bringing an idea to me. We do a thing that's called flavor association, which is a technique that we practice a lot. And that is where you take, for instance, salmon, for instance, and you draw a diagram of salmon, and then you list all the things that are delicious with salmon. And then on those things, you list all the things that are delicious with those items, and you keep concentric circles going out. Typically, by the time you get out here and you can relate it to salmon, you've got something pretty innovative.
Interesting.
And so we teach a lot of that. And so, young people, believe it or not, drive me nuts, but I find great value in them as well. Yeah.
Do Did you do anything like that with composition? I'm trying to think of that, like musical ideas and then thinking circles out. What might work with the phrase or something?
It's going to vary from student to student,
yeah.
And for me, from piece to piece.
Yeah.
I think there's kind of maybe a generic circle of possibilities within things, but it's going to be determined whether I'm using salmon or whether I'm using grouper.
Likewise.
right. So yeah. Same kind of thing. Yeah. So if I'm working with grouper, like one of the pieces I did this summer was just solo piano.
I want to hear your grouper.
Actually, most of it's a little bit of grouper, a little bit fishy. But so one of the pieces was for orchestra, and one piece was for piano. So there's certain limitations
yeah.
that you're going to work with if mm-hmm. you just have piano and one pianist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. In the music world, we think a lot about kind of schools of thought or these big trends, and you know, because we, you know, I teach music history at Butler, and so I'm teaching about how we relate to the past all the time. And you made mention earlier of some, you know, legendary composers of the 20th century that were still kind of in their shadows a little bit. Is that true in the restaurant world or the bar world as much? Is there these schools of thought and these trends that you have to approach? And,
certainly.
And if so, how do you do that in your
yeah,
own
certainly.
Work?
Yeah, certainly. Classic culinary techniques. You know, the French love to tell us that they are the French are the first formalized cuisine, right? That mm-hmm. that someone took the time to document all the foundations of the cuisine. Mm. So we'll give them that. but you know, there are many, many cultures out there that moms and dads and grandmas and granddads have passed on the oral history, sometimes mm-hmm. the written history of their family in the form of recipes, right?
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. It's a little unfair to say that that the French sort of dominate that. But yeah, I mean, usually our sort of foundations of cooking come from cultures.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be, you know, Asia, of course. Now, don't get me wrong. Asia's big in and of itself.
Mm-hmm.
The regions of Italy, Spain, of course, is a cuisine that has multiple regions to pull from. So, yeah, we do. We have these big schools, but they're generally specific to the cultures that we're trying to pull from.
Mm-hmm.
And you can sometimes get yourself in trouble by mixing those cultures in an inappropriate way. You know, I'm looking at you, 80s. You know, we got pretty wild in the 80s.
Yeah.
And we
thought
we...
in music, too.
yeah, we did, right? Yeah. Flock of Seagulls, you know, look no further. Yeah, so, you know, yeah, we, you know, that was the birth of fusion cooking.
Okay.
And that was a really sad time.
So...
for us.
Like, would we call it appropriation now? Is that what you're talking about? Is that,
absolutely.
And people get attacked for that in cooking? Because I hear it in music, people get attacked for that. But that's what it
interesting.
Is.
I've never thought of it that way, but that's exactly what it is. It's
okay.
Cultural
yeah,
misappropriation.
Yeah, people talk about cultural appropriation in music, and can a certain composer use a musical idea if it's not from their culture or not? And there are different schools of thought on that. I have a feeling you have a thought.
I have a very strong
all right,
thought.
Let's hear it.
Because, and I don't know. I'm just a street eater, but I love fusions of different cultures in food too.
A street eater.
In Tokyo, once I had it was called an American restaurant, but it was some odd coupling of hamburgers and
yeah.
rice and the warm towel. And
it's funny because Japan is notorious for bastardizing other cultures' foods. And they're the ones that like it the least if you bastardize
right.
their food.
That's right. Maybe just because I'm older, I know it's a huge, the cultural appropriation thing.
Mm-hmm.
The Room Full of Teeth were on our campus
yeah.
last year.
Yeah.
And they had a big talk about it.
Yeah.
And some of my students, and I think appropriately so, said... If isn't it kind of a respectful honor if you're inspired by a certain, say, Eastern or
mm-hmm.
Eastern European sound that's not part of your
mm-hmm.
culture from Brooklyn or from Detroit or whatever,
yeah.
and you're trying to learn it and embrace it, and if the answer is no, then we have to get rid of a lot of great composers. Like Lou Harrison
yeah.
and John Cage,
yeah.
they appropriated, but they were influenced, they were inspired, and they made it their own
yeah.
thing.
But with both of the examples, I think, just to play devil's advocate here, and
that's fine.
In general, I agree with you, but both the two examples you gave were of white men who, and I'm not, I don't want to attack, I love both of these composers, but I'm saying that this is the what people say about appropriation.
Okay.
Is it somebody in a position of power borrowing a musical style from a people group that has been either presently or historically oppressed in some way.
I see.
That oppression maybe led to a musical development.
I see.
You can think about like African American music in the Civil War era or something.
Sure,
the music that grew out of that, and then taking that music and leaving behind all the oppression that led to it,
yeah,
and then the person in power benefiting from it. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. It's a slippery slope.
I don't know.
Slope.
I could go either way on this issue.
No,
I'm just
I understand.
Trying to say, I think that's the other side of the argument.
No, that makes sense.
I
then it's in the hands of each composer, I guess, if they
yeah.
think that they're somehow screwing the people that gave them
yeah.
this gift, and
yeah.
they're going to the bank. It's a,
I don't know.
It's a tough call.
I don't know. Do people talk about this? Are we in the restaurant world?
I'm sitting here
this?
Thinking of examples, and
yeah.
I've thought of a couple. I actually had a conversation with a Mexican friend of mine because he made a statement, you know, white boy is doing tacos. Right? and I never thought, of course, I'm a privileged white guy, right? I never put myself in the position to think, is this potentially offensive, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And clearly... it was offending someone here in
mm-hmm.
this case. And so it was pretty interesting to hear that conversation. And then, of course, he kind of walked it back and was like, we don't care. It's just kind of funny to us, you know, white
yeah.
guys doing tacos.
Yeah.
And then, of course, I also think Southern barbecue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think that's something that when you see someone white, and I'm thinking specifically of Franklin Barbecue in Texas, I think they had a little bit of a hard road, and they had to really, really earn sort of their chops, right? And it took some old pit masters to come forward and be like, this guy is legit. This guy really knows what he's doing, right? And now Franklin Barbecue, of course, is it's a famous barbecue house. But
yeah,
so there are examples of that for
mm-hmm.
sure. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little sad.
Yeah, and I don't necessarily know where we need to go. I'm starting to understand both sides of
yeah.
it. But I don't know, where do you think... Either of you, like in the restaurant world, the music world, where do you think this might lead in the next couple decades? I mean, are people going to be afraid to experiment with the art of other cultures?
In music,
or?
They seem to be already.
Oh, it's already happening.
It seems
happening,
to
you
be
think?
such a wall, such a stumbling
mm-hmm.
block now in the last 5-6 years,
hmm.
Especially. I've even had students say, "Do you think this is okay because it sounds kind of, you know,
something
Romanian
else.
Or something?"
Okay, yeah.
And I'm not sure what to say. Hundreds of composers imitated Bartok.
Yeah.
And they're not Hungarian.
Yeah.
Hundreds of composers imitated Stravinsky, and they're not Russian,
yeah.
and they're not from L.A. It's a fine line, and I think it comes
yeah.
back to each composer just being true to themselves, saying,
mm-hmm.
I'm sorry if people that created this style weren't able to... benefit from
yeah.
it, but I don't know that it should stop me because I don't know them. Might sound a little cold, but
I think there are ways to artistically do it respectfully.
Respectfully,
you know,
yeah,
and, but,
yeah,
I don't know. What about in the restaurant world?
Yeah,
are people afraid maybe of taking some of these risks?
I don't think they are
okay.
at all, because I don't think the conversation has been had, frankly. I don't think we've touched on
that. We talk too much in music. So.
Yeah, a lot.
Anyway,
continue.
Well, it's interesting because I do think that the conversation is probably overdue.
Hmm.
We don't talk about it as an industry, but I will tell you that nothing, you know, I brought up fusion cuisine.
Mm-hmm.
Chefs universally hate the word fusion.
Mm-hmm.
Cuisine. You ask any chef, they're going to say, yeah, we don't mess with fusion cuisine, right?
Mm.
And so with young cooks that aren't disciplined cooks, that are idealistic, they think the world is their oyster, and they have this, they have a tendency to pull from many, many cultures. One of my responsibilities is to draw them in.
Mm-hmm.
That's 85% of the time what I'm saying no to is a concept that they are trying to pull into a dish that's unnecessary, but they think is super cool because it's probably from another culture.
I see.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you can put anything in a tortilla and call it a taco. Yeah. That doesn't mean that it should happen, right? Yeah. A great cocktail example, by the way, I don't have to say this to this team because they're disciplined now and they're very good. Bartenders are notorious for coming to the head chef or to the bar owner and saying, I want to do a riff, or they'll hand you a cocktail and they'll say, I want to do a riff on an old fashioned. Mm-hmm. The first thing I say to them is, no, because an old fashioned is a classic cocktail that is conceptually perfect.
Yeah.
What makes you think that you're going to improve upon it, right? Yeah. And when you put it in those terms, I think it forces them to go back and rethink, well, why is it a riff on an old fashioned, right? Mm. Is it the build or is it the core spirit, whatever? But it also makes them, I hope, it gives them the discipline to come up with their own classic cocktail, you know?
Yeah. That's interesting. So, go ahead, sorry.
No.
So what are some of, let's get back to you guys. We've been talking about the field a little bit. What are some of the best experiments or the most fruitful over the last few years that you had that maybe you're proud of, something that went really well, a new idea you had in music that maybe people looked at you, Mike, like, why are we doing this, or something
No. Five or six years ago, I did a piece for cello and orchestra that was going to be toured throughout China with an American orchestra.
Okay.
I did a lot of research. I had to embrace that culture somehow. I wanted to, because the conductor said they will love it if you acknowledge them, basically.
Give them a nod.
Yeah, give them a nod. So if you put a folk song in it or something, and I thought, oh, I don't know this folk song, but they loved it. They loved that we did it.
Yeah.
The piece is different than anything I've ever done because it has that kind of pentatonic Chinese scale effect.
Yeah.
There's some speaking in the piece in Chinese.
Oh,
I don't speak Chinese, but the cellist yells something in Chinese, and the conductor, and the Chinese audiences loved it. Apparently, I was nervous about doing it.
Yeah.
Like, who am I?
You
know, I live in Indiana. For God's sake. So that was an experiment that I was nervous about.
Yeah,
that was like, woo! It turned out okay.
What about you, Neal? What are some of the things some of the risks you've taken?
This specific thing came from out of necessity, frankly. So, you know, Yukio, we do a dinner that's called omakase. Omakase means to trust the chef. I do a 12-course tasting menu it's at the sushi bar, and it's for up to eight people at a time, right? And so one of the dishes that I came up with for that, I wanted to do unagi. Unagi is freshwater eel. It's heavily, heavily overfished, and it's under threat. It's considered to be a worst choice seafood.
Wow.
And so, but it's delicious, and it's amazing, and it's texturally really complex, and it's fatty, but it's lean at the same time, and it's just really delicious. And anyone that's ever had it goes, wow, yeah, it's great. It's like one of my favorites, right? I didn't want to do unagi. We claim that we try very hard to be a sustainable seafood restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
And so we were playing around with catfish one day, and we were glazing and broiling catfish, and we tasted it. And it occurred to me that this tasted just like unagi. So now we do a dish that is farm-raised, organic catfish, domestically raised. So its carbon footprint is low. It's got amazing protein, very little fat. And it's, frankly, to me, it's one of the most sort of iconic dishes that we'll do at Yukio because it solved a problem for us in a way that had a really amazing result. So it was out of necessity, but turned into something that I think, frankly, could be industry changing. As we looked into it, the physiology of the catfish, fat content, the environment that the fish comes from are all incredibly similar. Catfish is essentially an eel. Believe it or not.
I mean, really?
If you look at it,
The
physiology is very similar. It just isn't as elongated. The fillets are very similar. So, that was by mistake. It wasn't intentional, but we evolved it in a very intentional way. And it's probably one of the things I'm most proud of in the year that Yukio's been open.
Wow. All right. I'll check that out. I love the sentence. We were playing around with catfish.
Yeah, right? Right. We try to incorporate as many landlocked freshwater fish as we can into Yukio, because in Japan, sushi was born from the rice fields. It was not born from coastal waters. It was actually born inland.
Okay.
Because it was cured fish. And we try to take that approach.
Interesting. Yeah. That's fascinating. Yeah. All right. Well, I don't know about you guys. I'm about ready for a drink. What do you
me
think?
Me too, and not all water. Right, yeah.
So why don't we go ahead and try...
Yeah, you want to do the shirt tucker?
Yeah, that sounded great. So Neal has brought us our first round of cocktails here. It looks and smells amazing. I can't wait. Tell me what we got here.
Yeah, so this to me is quintessential autumn flavors. This is Old Forester bourbon with Laird's Applejack brandy and some sherry, some Fino sherry. This is called the Shirt Tucker. This is on our new cocktail list that literally came out this week. So, I'm excited because anytime there's a new cocktail list, it means I have to go down through the cocktail list, of course, and taste
quality control, right?
Yeah, I mean, you have to do audits. Autumnal, very. It is strong. I'm not gonna. I'm not gonna make a chain there.
There we go.
Just different enough from a Manhattan, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Manhattan-esque.
But what's this aftertaste I'm getting? There's something that hits late.
It's probably the sherry.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's probably the sherry.
Yeah. Oh, that's nice.
So the ingredients?
Yeah, so
or
it's...
Or is that a secret?
No. I'm going to tell you as soon as I look up all the ingredients.
It's so smooth.
Because these guys...
This is delightful.
So you can also be getting probably a little bit of the Jamaican bitters, which is black peppercorn and thyme.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Never even heard of that. This
yeah, Jamaican
fantastic.
Bitters.
Okay.
Peychaud's bitters. Mm-hmm. A little bit of Indiana maple syrup in there as well.
Wow. You can taste a little sweet.
Yeah, that's the sweetness in there.
No.
Because this is pure booze. I mean, this is a very alcohol forward cocktail.
Yeah.
This is, you know, as we would say in the industry, this is boozy and stirred.
Okay.
This is a sipper you would likely finish your work day and finish dinner with this, right?
Yeah.
You wouldn't.
Yeah.
This isn't one you just have for lunch these days.
Feeling remarkably warmer and content already. Mm-hmm. I can tell. And then the garnish is just is this a black cherry or what is it?
Yeah, it's a Luxardo Maraschino cherry.
Okay.
Wow.
Those are Italian cherries that have been preserved and brandy and in their own sort of liqueur.
Mm-hmm.
This is the classic Maraschino cherry, not the, you know, you see the bright red cherries that we're kind of all used to when we were younger.
Yeah.
Like we're in your Shirley Temple.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those belong in Shirley Temples. These belong in delicious, amazing cocktails.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So we're going to pick a piece of music here in a minute
to
pair with this. What are some, I don't know, some adjectives we need to, how would, if you were describing this to a customer, what catches you first?
I wouldn't pick an angry piece.
Yeah,
for sure.
Very, yeah.
And
set you down at the end of the day, I feel like. Very
this is an unwinding cocktail, right?
Yeah. 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 Okay. But the piece would have to have a lot of life to it, but it would have to have an overall optimistic feel to it rather than, so, what comes to mind?
Yeah. My mood is certainly lifted already.
I
can see what you mean. Something.
Central Park in the Dark by Ives.
Okay.
That's the piece.
It just happens on the show.
The piece
that's how it
came
works.
To mind.
The music guest eventually just comes up with something.
I really want to hear it.
We're going to listen to it here in just a second, actually.
Good.
Yeah.
Good.
It just kind of floats along, and you're a little cautious because it's Central Park in the Dark, but nothing bad happens in the piece. So there's a lot of ingredients in the piece, but the overall feeling is like,
why don't we go ahead and give that a listen?
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, so we're listening to this Charles Ives drinking this amazing cocktail. What do you think? Did Mike get it right?
I think he nailed it. I want my slippers. I want a fire. I want the leaves to turn overnight.
Perfect.
Yeah,
Perfect.
I think it's amazing.
Great.
It's a great piece.
Yeah, there's a warmth and it's very approachable, this piece. And you were talking about how this doesn't really sound like, when people think of Charles Ives, if they're classical music fans.
Right.
If they're not, how would you describe Charles Ives to someone who is not a classical music fan?
He appropriates everything, but he lived in it. Chaos.
When was he writing? Early 20th century.
Early 20th century, yeah. He very well known for basically fusing multiple styles, popular music of the time in the early 20th century, traditional European classical music, just smashing it all together, and that pioneer spirit that you don't see in Europe, and that still is the hallmark of American composers.
Yeah.
Let's try this and see what happens, and you know, the heck with it. Still a huge influence for
That's interesting, the American thing, because you said there's some sort of like American characteristics to this cocktail, right?
Well, our tagline for this bar is celebrating the pioneering American spirit.
Oh, perfect.
Wow.
Perfect.
So I think you nailed it. I mean, Old Forester is a pioneering American spirit.
Yeah,
right?
It's been around a long time.
Yeah.
But this piece by Ives, it's not the cacophonous, like sometimes he has pieces that sound like a marching band walking away from you or something. But this piece, it's just so gorgeous. It's that same pioneering spirit, but in the, I don't know, maybe at the end of a hard day of pioneering, when you relax a little bit.
You're right.
Let your guard down for the evening.
And when
if only they were so lucky.
Yeah.
Exactly. And when that piece was written, I'm guessing Central Park was pretty peaceful 100 years ago. You walk through at night, and the harvest moon, and the young lovers by the lake, and different world.
All right, I'm going to eat my cherry here now.
We'll
move on to the next cocktail soon. But I do kind of feel like I need dessert after this meal of a cocktail.
Yeah, right?
An infused cherry.
Yeah, it's a great one. Very clean. Yeah. I love how clean it is. It finishes clean.
One more time, the name of this?
This is called the Shirt Tucker.
Shirt Tucker, okay.
And, you know, to get back on something we talked about earlier, this is, as I said earlier, you know, if someone brings an old, they say, well, this is a riff on an old fashioned. This is an example of someone who is disciplined as a bartender, Zach Beeson, our head bartender, being able to be innovative because he's disciplined, right? We touched on that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And this is, I can't call it a riff on a Manhattan, but if someone wants a Manhattan and you hand them this, they're going to be very, very happy with the result, you know?
Yeah. I certainly like this more than most Manhattan, but I love the Manhattan. I mean, it's a great cocktail.
I'm a Manhattan drinker. It is my favorite cocktail.
I think I had two yesterday, so it's not like it's been long since I've had a Manhattan. But.
Yeah, I'm not going to talk about my Manhattan count over the weekend. But I would be satisfied drinking this if someone came in and said, I want a Manhattan. We would approach that with saying, you know, you should try this instead. So.
Yeah. Well, so we were, while we were serving these drinks, we were having a little conversation, but we're talking about how, and in music especially, and I think as we're learning, this is true in the cocktail and the restaurant world, you have to really know the rules before you can break the rules. And that can be tough, I think, for some people who want to immediately start breaking the rules. So we were talking about in music that until you know how counterpoint music theory work and how you're supposed to write, you can't learn how to break all those rules and come up with something new. I don't know. Do you talk to your students that way, Mike, or is that something that's
very much? I'm trained by all Europeans, and so it's in my blood and in my soul to say you need to know the rules before you can break them.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
I remind them that Philip Glass knew all the rules.
Yeah,
he said, "I don't want to do them, but I know how they work." I think that's an important one.
Yeah.
I
you mentioned Stravinsky earlier. I think Stravinsky knew the rules
before
he wrote The Rite of
all
Spring.
The rules,
but he knew how to break them.
Frank Zappa knew the rules.
Yeah.
He learned them on his own from people like Stravinsky and Bartok and all that, and then he took his own path with it. But at the same time, you have to be careful because you don't want to squash their curiosity and their enthusiasm.
Yeah.
You don't want to say, 100 people have done that. You want to say, that's great. and kind of gently, you know, yeah. say, it's cool. It's been done a little bit before, but your way's maybe a little bit different. That's mm-hmm. good, but get to know these pieces. And
yeah.
you don't want to tarnish their enthusiasm,
yeah.
their curiosity.
Yeah, you have to build them up. You have to build
yep.
people up.
Yep.
Yeah.
Mm. Yep.
Interesting. Yep. All right, so you have another cocktail for us, right?
Yeah, are you guys up yeah. for it?
Let's go round two.
All right.
So as I said earlier, I was very excited about doing this episode of the Libertine because I've always had some amazing cocktails here. The one that was just put in front of me is one of the most incredible things I think I've ever seen. I'm very excited about it. So go ahead and tell me all about it, Neal. And you know, maybe speak quickly so I can drink it soon.
Yeah, you got it. You got it.
Now tell
you got
us
it.
Everything about what we're looking at.
I talk fast anyway. So so this is called the Cult Following. The star of the show here is Sotal. Sotal is a cousin of the agave plant. Grows in Chihuahua, Durango, northwest Mexico.
Okay.
It's got a little bit of the same profile as agave. It comes from a cactus called the desert spoon. Sotal means desert spoon.
Is that this thing here?
Nope.
That's something different.
That okay, is I'm lavender,
sorry
to, yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Lavender.
No, it's okay. That's just a little sprig of dried lavender. And so this cocktail is a very, very, very complex cocktail. It has a lot going on. When you look at this cocktail on paper, you would say, I don't know how this is going to work. That was my first reaction when they presented this cocktail to me. And, you know, again, that discipline and creativity, they were able to make something that seems to make no sense make perfect sense. So the purpose of the lavender, you would actually put that opposite of your mouth.
Okay. And so if you're just listening to the podcast, there'll be a picture of this on our Instagram page and our website, so
right.
you can see what we're looking at here.
And so this is a calabash seed. This is a typical drinking vessel for Sotal in South America, Central America. But what you would do with the lavender is you would just have it so that your nose, you get the olfactory sensation of the lavender as you're sipping the cocktail. And it's wildly delicious.
Wow.
Really, it's a challenging cocktail.
Yeah, I lack the vocabulary to describe it all. Yeah. Just, yeah. So tell me, explain to me what I'm experiencing here.
Yeah, so that really green vegetal sensation is the Sotal itself.
Okay.
That's sort of that.
Yeah, it's kind of sharp, and it kind of gets you in the back of the tongue.
Is yeah,
that,
for
that's,
sure.
That's what you're talking about? Okay.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Lime, of course, it does have an infusion of hops. In the cocktail too, which lends again to it just kind of that just supports the vegetal sort of quality of mezcal. Hops have a very sort of green gardeny sort of nose to them. They do come from the marijuana, you know, they come from hemp, right? They're
okay,
a
yeah.
cousin of hemp, so they've got that really sort of vegetal quality. A little bit of honey and a little bit of lime, and then of course the lavender. So yeah. It's a complex cocktail.
Yeah, and there's something very, I don't know, like, the last one was so dignified. The sort of the shirt talker, right, is what you called
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
maybe not the most dignified name, but definitely a very
yeah.
dignified cocktail.
Yeah.
It sort of tastes like a Manhattan. You know, we listened to music about Central Park because that made sense. This isn't a completely different world. I mean, this
completely
is,
different
is,
world.
I don't know what kind of, almost... And not to use this word like derogatorily, but almost like primitive-ish or like it's a very rural, very like this combination of flavors. I don't know. What's striking you about it, Mike?
I can't wait for this.
I don't want to let you down.
I can't wait for this.
It's a whole different world than the first one. The first sip is just alive with so many different, very powerful flavors.
Yeah.
The citrus and then the olfactory effect of that on your nose when you're
The lavender
it's just
it shouldn't work.
So here's my question: how many experiments before you come up with the right proportions of each thing?
Hopefully
of each
many
ingredient.
Hopefully many. because the minute that they get it right on the first one, I'm going to lose them. They're going to open their own bar.
Right. So many experiments.
I think many iterations.
A little more of this, a little less of this.
Yeah, I think many iterations. This particular team, these guys are good friends, and so they collaborate on everything. This menu is entirely collaborative between between Zach and Skaggs.
Those are the main bartenders here at the Libertine.
So this is their minds coming together and creating this cocktail.
All right, Mike, what are you thinking?
I can't wait to hear the music.
You've
had plenty of time.
Music?
Yeah. So I mean, this is.
Well, it's definitely not Central Park in the Dark.
It's like mariachi to me. Like,
There's an Andy Akiho piece that's very, very popular. Do you know this composer? He's in his 50s, contemporary composer.
Okay.
A lot of percussion stuff.
Yeah, well, we can certainly talk about it. And I definitely want to highlight living composers. Classical music is filled with living, brilliant composers that a lot of people don't hear, unfortunately. So just describe the piece a little bit. And then we'll listen to it.
He's American, mm-hmm. but Japanese ancestry,
mm-hmm.
And he does a lot of work with multiple percussion,
mm-hmm.
and piano and occasional acoustic instruments with it, mm-hmm. but a lot of vibraphone and marimba and xylophone, mm-hmm. very rhythmic, very energetic, very spicy.
Let's go ahead and let's do that one. Let's listen to that, because I would love to highlight a composer that most people don't know. Wow, I'm impressed, Mike. So I'm gonna jump the gun here and say I think you've done a really good job with this pairing, because this cocktail was something that I did not expect to experience today, and it's just unbelievably vibrant and delicious. Yeah. And this piece of music, I've never heard of this composer, to be totally honest, and it's simply stunning. And so we'll put up a link to this piece as well,
Great.
So people can find out some information about it. Because supporting living composers is so important. But what did you think, Neal?
I thought it was, again, spot on. I mean, it's vibrant, it's exciting, it's very complex. I think all the things that this cocktail sort of is. I really like it. Forget the cultural, appropriation part.
Right.
I think it's amazing. Yeah, I loved it.
I'll listen to it again. Yeah, what was the name of the piece? I don't think we said that.
It's a kind of a hipster title of 21st century.
No one
capital
to no
letters
one?
With small letters. No one to no one with various capital and lowercase letters. No one,
yeah. Yeah, very hipster.
Yeah. It's very to me. It's very influenced by Zappa from the 70s and 80s. It has that same kind of driving, kind of vertical. Everybody's lined up.
Do you know roughly when this piece was premiered?
I think it's pretty new. Five years. Maybe.
Okay. Wow. Okay. Yeah. Great. You stand by your pairing.
Yes, I do.
You'll plant your flag there and say,
I will. He's very, very, very well known in the percussion world.
Okay.
He's becoming better known in the concert world, and he's a faculty at a university now.
Okay, so wonderful. That's
he's
great.
Mainstream.
Yeah. Well, that's a really, a very exciting piece. And it's nice to think of that being written recently. And it's nice. I think that's the kind of piece that will bring in some people that maybe enjoy classical music, but are mostly familiar with the big canon,
Right.
the Mozart, the Beethoven. Right. But someone, I mean, there's just something about composers who are responding to right now. You know, like Mozart was responding to his situation in the 1780s. That's not our situation.
Right.
But composers who are responding to what life is like in the 21st century and being able to really enjoy that art music and reflect on your own life. And, I don't know. Do you think you might play it sometime here at the Libertine?
Yeah, it would
play in the background for people.
I doubt it.
every time someone orders it.
I think a bar fight might break out with that piece. It's pretty chaotic.
All right, well, someone can bring their headphones in.
It'd be interesting to know the background of that piece, though, right? Like what the inspiration behind that piece was, because I think you said it very well. It sounds very, very contemporary.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we're talking about this issue earlier of, you know, I use the word appropriation. I mean, there's more, that's a negative way to look at it. There are more positive ways to look at the sort of cultural sharing and understanding.
You're right.
And I think, you know, so the first half of the show, we were kind of talking about I was playing devil's advocate, but I do think very beautiful about, you know, all humans in the planet and forever have had emotions and have wanted to express those emotions. And some of them choose to do it through music. I think some choose to do it through cocktails and food and that sort of thing. It's all these creative expressions. And I think there's something really beautiful about the potential of sharing these musical ideas and coming up with new visions and new ways to express themselves or their community or whatever the case may be. I don't know. Do you feel that way?
I do, and I'll stand by my feeling for that about the appropriation thing. Mm-hmm. He's American citizen, mm-hmm. Japanese ancestry, mm-hmm. but in that piece, there's a steel band, a steel pan. Player. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, he's not Jamaican.
Yeah.
The player isn't from Jamaica.
Yeah.
But we're absorbing these cultures mm-hmm. and letting them influence a piece like this.
Yeah. I think that's where classical music, and that's where the world is going, of course, right? I mean, as we're getting more and more globalized,
right.
As the world gets smaller and smaller every day with, you know, travel and the internet and whatnot,
right.
That the cultural sharing, I mean, we're going to have to share. I mean, it's inevitable that we're going to have to come up with ways to express ourselves. Yeah, and the more we can do to appreciate and understand and love the artistic traditions of other cultures in a respectful and enjoyable way, I think is really exciting. And I think, honestly, this cocktail sort of does that. This is not the normal cocktail that someone would drink in Indiana.
Right.
You know, we're clearly being influenced by another culture here that we are not.
For
but
sure.
I think we're doing this in a respectful way. I think we're.
Yeah, I think so too.
Yeah. So we're going to wrap up here in a bit, but real quick, if you're watching online, you've seen this beautiful bottle here, and if you're listening, you've heard this beautiful bottle. I'm kidding. You haven't, of course, you're not aware of it, but there's this really fascinating bottle, and Mike, you were telling us a story about it earlier.
I
want to hear just a little bit about this bottle.
Okay, very, very brief history. I couldn't resist when Neal emailed us and said we were going to be trying a couple of little different, he mentioned Japanese possibility. Yeah. And I have had this for almost my whole life. My dad was in World War II in the Pacific Theater, and when he came home in 1945, he said one of his fondest memories is Old Suntory Japanese whiskey.
Okay.
But you couldn't get it in America right after the war because the Japanese, because of the American occupation of Japan. As soon as that lifted in 1950, which 53, I think, which is the year, the same year that Godzilla was allowed to be released. Godzilla was actually made in 1947, but the Americans said, no, you can't release it because Godzilla is us.
Oh,
the fire-breathing dragon that comes from the ocean and destroys Japan. So, anyhow.
That just got really heavy.
this is really special to me. The bottle's got to be 70, 75 years old.
That's amazing.
Right after the war. So I thought these guys might get a kick out of it.
Yeah,
so,
I definitely get a kick out of it. Yeah, that's an incredible bottle.
That's really beautiful.
I want to take a picture of that.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I've had such a nice time talking with both of you. If you haven't been to Libertine or if you haven't been in a while, make sure to come. The cocktails are here, amazing. The menu book itself is a work of art. I love that. There's all these different images and colors, and I can't even describe it on an audio podcast. But this is one of the best spots in town to get some really exciting and innovative cocktails. For example, the ones we've had today, which were the Cult Following.
Cult Following is the Sutol cocktail that we just talked about, and then the Shirt Tucker was the Old Forester whiskey and Applejack based cocktail that we had.
And then make sure to check out some of the some of Neal's other restaurants. What, you mentioned a couple earlier, but you said what's the one with the catfish? Because I need to go have that.
So that's Yukio, Yukio, our Japanese restaurant, and then we've got Daredevil Hall at 82nd Street, Pizzology, which I actually just sold, but you should go there anyway.
Okay,
it's still delicious. My management staff bought the restaurant.
So
it's still a great restaurant. Yeah, and then Midtown Provisions, of course, at Butler University.
They'll be opening. That's exciting.
Soon.
Yeah.
We look forward.
Yeah, we'll be there. Well, that's wonderful. All right. Well, this has been a real pleasure and an honor for me to talk with both of you.
Likewise.
Well,
thank you. I appreciate that.
Really great.
So thank you so much for listening. Make sure, we're also going to link to some Mike Shelley's music. There's some really fantastic pieces. And then make sure to swing by the Libertine. So thank you so much, everybody.
Thanks.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank my guests, Neal Brown, owner of the Libertine and many other restaurants and bars around Indianapolis, and Michael Schelle, professor of composition at Butler University. If you'd like to learn more about Neal Brown's many restaurants, check out neilbrownhospitality.com. And if you'd like to hear more about Michael Shelley's music, check out shelleymusic.com. We'd also like to thank our sponsor, Matinee Creative, for supporting this podcast. If you like what you heard and want to hear more great classical music, you can tune in to Classical Music Indie's syndicated broadcasts on your favorite local radio station. Just check out classicalmusicindie.org and click On Air for schedules. You can find more Classical Pairings in Note Magazine, along with features on other great local artists. Check out classicalmusicindie.org to subscribe. Our executive producer is Anna Pranger-Sleppy, and the production team comes from WFYI. I'm your host, Nick Johnson, and be sure to catch all our episodes by subscribing.